Hello and welcome to the Dad and Buried podcast. As always, my name is Mike, aka Dad and Buried, and joining me tonight is my co-host, Mom and Buried. It's nice to see you.
Hi.
Once again, we are right next to each other. You may realize we have a slightly different backdrop. We're experimenting. You know what? We don't rest on our laurels. We're just giving a couple of things some shots. She's delighted with it. She loves the real quick, you know, makeshift fly with the seat of your pants.
Just throw shit together.
Before we started recording, she wasn't.
Set up around us right now.
She wasn't furious at all right before we started recording and giving me shit.
He has so much cleaning to do after this.
And I'm going
to
do about 75% of it, as always. So this week, we're going to be talking about the things you wish you'd known about parenting before you became a parent. And frankly, I'm shocked that we haven't done this topic before, especially because we got so many responses that we're splitting up into two episodes.
Well, no, before we even got responses, I'm like, you guys never did that? Because, you know, I don't listen to this podcast, when I'm on it.
She doesn't.
Certainly not when I'm not on it.
And you should listen. You get some tips. You listen yourself over and you figure out what you can do better. That's what I do every week. I spend a couple hours listening to my old podcast and seeing how great I did.
Well, that explains the 75% at best that you're putting into the other chores around
the cleaning. So look, it's a hot topic, as they say. Nobody's ever called it that, but there's not one of the through lines of my entire online personality, which is very much a character and not at all what I'm like in real life.
Almost exactly at this point. I feel like there used to be a bigger divide, only now it's narrow.
That's not a podcast topic. That's a marriage counseling topic. So one of my big things, as I started my blog, my Dad and Mary blog, which was the first thing I did a few months before Detective Munch was born. And one of the things, aside from how having a kid doesn't have to destroy your personality and change your life, was that there's no such thing as a parenting expert. Nobody knows what they're doing. And I think that's 100% true. And a lot of the answers that we got from this are from parents who maybe had some ideas about what it was like and then quickly were quickly disabused of those notions and realized that once you start to actually parent, you weren't prepared at all because there's no real way to be prepared. And some of the responses we got are jokey and funny about, you know, what they wish they had known before they had their kids. And some of them are really, you know, heartfelt and real about the challenges of being a parent and how hard it can be, especially when you come in with kind of certain expectations and that kind of thing, which you quickly learn. Like I said, you get disabused. I like that term, disabused. Do you like it? She's not a great place right now. I got a ton of response. We're going to split it up. And next week, hopefully Pete will be back to help tackle some of the stuff that maybe is a little bit more in his wheelhouse. Like the marriage stuff is going to be Mom and Buried's domain. She has a lot to say about how great our marriage is. What's funny is this stuff about...
Yeah, we don't really go into marriage stuff.
No, there's a marriage. We're going
to... this isn't a marriage.
No. But marriage in relation to parenting, right? So how you relate to your partner when it comes to parenting and that kind of stuff is a big aspect of being a good parent, is being on the same page as your partner. And some of the responses that I got to this definitely go into that. But what's funny about this is almost everything that everyone said, I already knew. Like, I'm probably the best parent who's ever lived. I knew everything beforehand, and everything that I thought was going to be reality quickly was dead on, spot on, right? Like, I'm probably the best parent you've ever come across. I'm the funniest person you've ever met.
No.
The best parent that you've probably ever interacted with in any way. Better than your parents, certainly.
Please.
So, look, we got a lot of stuff to get into. Some really, really good responses. I'm excited to talk about.
No, I actually wanted to say something about that.
About what?
The whole you being a great parent thing.
Oh, Jesus.
No. About you feeling like you knew it all, da-da-da-da, right? Like, that's you?
No, look, that was obviously a joke. I had never even touched
a baby.
The one time I touched a baby before I had my own baby, I dropped him on his face. My friend's baby. I took the kid, I was holding him, and then, like, I'm like, what's this kid, 10 months old? And I just set him on his feet, and he went... Tim Bird, smack. He was wearing a helmet because he needed one of those helmets to shape his head.
He wasn't 10 months old. You can't walk at 10 months old. He wasn't strutting about the place.
No. He was about 9 or 10 months old. I just was like, this kid can stand at this point, right? And I just put him on his feet, not knowing that babies can't. He couldn't at that point. Or maybe he was younger than that, is what you're saying?
Yeah, is what I'm saying, yes, because some could. It was evident, though, throughout the 3 days with these people,
that
this baby could not stand, no matter his age.
I wasn't paying attention. Why would I pay attention to a baby? This is the thing. I went into, before I had a kid, I didn't care about babies. I still barely care about babies
and
or
kids. And
it's
like the
kids.
First baby, yes, that I think you ever touched. I grew up
it could
with
not have been the first baby
nieces
ever touched,
and nephews.
I had never changed the diaper.
I certainly would not have let you touch my baby at
so
the time.
In a way, that was good because I didn't come into it with a lot of preconceptions or, you know, that could end up being misconceptions, right? I didn't know anything about it. And I wrote a blog post once about how men, in a lot of cases, like, so women, if you get pregnant and immediately, biologically, something is going on and psychologically you're affected for 9 months, you have this slow thing growing in you and it affects everything about you. As for a guy, in a lot of cases, it's just like, no baby, and then all of a sudden, one day you got a baby, and you gotta learn what to do. It's like a magic trick, boom, baby, and then your life is fucking absolutely destroyed. So I didn't have a ton of like, oh, this is what I'm gonna do, this is what I'm not gonna do. I wasn't one of those parents that was like, no screen time for my kid, you know, no sugar.
No, the one thing I guess you said that you wouldn't do before having a baby was you were not going to have your life stolen away, your identity stolen away. And that's when he actually started
the Dad
and Barry blog, before the social media, before the podcast.
I had seen a lot of friends that had kids before me, including the friend whose child I could have, you know, really injured, but he was fine. So he had the helmet, so it even broke his paw.
Yeah, it's fine.
It's great.
It's
perfect. Love that kid. So part of the reason, like, I saw a lot of my friends who suddenly were retreating from our social lives because they had a baby they don't take care of, and like their personalities were suddenly like just calming down and becoming more boring. And I was like, fuck that, it's not gonna happen to me. One of the ways I'm gonna keep my personality and my sense of humor going was through my blog and writing sarcastically and cynically the way I always did, mostly about pop culture, but now about, you know, parenting and becoming a parent. Try my best to hang on to our lifestyle, which I think we did a very good job at. And then we had a second
kid.
Especially
the first
one. Yeah, it gets a lot harder when you have two kids. We're going to get into that a little bit.
And then you hit
a
pandemic. I mean, shit starts to really go.
I wasn't totally wrong about that. I wasn't totally wrong about being able to do that. I think it comes down to, like, your priorities and what you want to do. A lot of people have a kid and they're like, all right, now I just get to sit at home.
Yeah, now
this is my life. I was born to be a dad. I was born to be a dad.
Is this one of our topics, the identity and stuff?
I don't remember. Maybe.
We should talk to it because, you know, yes, there are some things that, like,
lose along the way when your personality can sometimes get subsumed by becoming a parent. And I wanted to prevent that from happening.
I think we both were dedicated to that, which is why Detective Munch, our first one, spent a lot of time in bars.
Yeah,
on
so
iPads,
much time in the
so
bars.
So many time in bars.
A lot of sleeping in the bars. Oh, and Ireland strapped
bars,
to our chests. Yeah.
Ireland bars, all kinds of bars.
You brought a baby in a bar? What movie is that? Sweet Home Alabama?
I don't know. I brought a baby in all the bars.
Every bar.
And also, if you're a new listener, this is a great intro to the Dad and Barry podcast.
The whole experience.
The whole,
right? Please.
The whole thing.
They know about my, even if this is the first time listening to my podcast, they know about my Instagram. Fucking huge on Instagram. I'm joking. It's all I do is joke. I'm a piece of shit. Just deal with it. You know this. You know I'm a piece of shit.
I mean, I'm actually really catching up to you on Instagram, and I'm an awesome person, and I started like
you're an
much
awesome person. None of these
later than
fine.
You.
You're a better person than me. I don't know if that makes you awesome. It's a low bar to be better than me. Anyway, all right. So we're gonna come back from
the
break.
This
we're gonna
the
talk
end of
about
Valentine's
the
Day
stuff
version.
That we wish you'd known about parent. You wish you'd known about parenting before you became a parent. Is that right? Yeah.
Sure.
I think that was the name of it. We'll be right back.
Okay, I have to fix my drink, and we have to fix this lighting. It's making me really disappointed.
Okay.
There's something he probably doesn't know about, but it might not even just be this. It might be partially that, the fan and the moving.
All right, welcome back to the Dad and Barry podcast. As I said earlier, the episode is stuff you wish you knew before you became a parent, that you can only really learn once you become a parent. So hopefully if you don't have kids or you're expecting kids and you're listening, you're going to get some tips.
Yeah,
you're gonna,
you should definitely listen.
A little bit of a reality check about what to expect, because there's a lot of bullshit out there.
And this is one episode for
We should have called this What to Expect When You're Expecting, shouldn't we? Maybe I should write a book with that name. This is episode, like, I don't know, 95 or something. Who keeps track?
I can't believe it took that long, though.
I know, neither can I. So we got a ton of responses.
Let's
get started. All right, so before we get into that really quick, I want to remind everybody that you can subscribe and download the Dadaberry podcast on Anchor, Apple, anywhere you listen to your podcasts. You can leave us reviews and ratings. We would love that. Please subscribe and tell your friends. You can go to YouTube and watch us and leave comments under individual episodes. You can even go to Patreon and throw us a little bit of money, or Anchor. A whole bunch of people do that. We really appreciate you. Nowhere near enough people do that. We could use more money.
Seriously.
Use more money so we can get a different backdrop for this. All right. So again, before we get into the topic, I want to talk about this weekend. So we had spring break for our kids last week. We took a couple of days. We went to Philadelphia.
Key West!
And just walked in Key West. Duval Street. We took a walk around Philadelphia, and then we went and visited my family in Connecticut for Easter, which neither of us really give a shit about. Great to see my parents.
Been since like last...
The end of August or something.
Since July.
So
it was big.
My parents have gotten vaccinated. Mom and Barry has gotten vaccinated. And I have also gotten vaccinated. So we were able to visit. Even my brothers and their significant others, or at least one of them, had gotten vaccinated.
Well,
so
yeah,
we were able to
their,
visit.
Well, yeah, due to their jobs and just knowing that vaccination is fucking key. And please,
everybody please get vaccinated. Even if you're somebody who's higher risk, like my wife here, who it's not a cure-all. It's not going to solve everything. We still have to be cautious.
Keep in mind, there are definitely people out there that still, like me, it's not a 95% you're totally covered thing. There's lots of people who
because of her multiple sclerosis and the immunosuppressing drugs that she has to remain on.
You know, it sucks. Lots of people, cancer patients, all those people, they need you. So that's my soapbox right there.
So it was lovely to let our kids do an Easter egg hunt in Grandma and Pop-Pop's yard and
drink some champagne
and drink some beer. So today is National Beer Day, and when I was in Connecticut, my brother got me some beer from the Fat Orange Cat Brewery. It's called Baby Kittens. It is,
shout out to Uncle and Barry,
delicious. Yeah, Uncle and Barry. I'm having some of that. It is very good. Yeah, I really appreciate it. Thanks, bro.
Let me taste it in the name of National Beer Day.
It's a waste of giving you sips. You don't even like beer. It's an absolute waste to give any to you. And it bothers me that you're
taking
some of
it. That's not true. I actually love good beer.
You'll just fall asleep if you finish it.
But it does not agree with me. Like, it just makes me pass out.
Well,
which is,
you know what?
Not fun.
It doesn't agree with me either, but I wrestle it into submission.
I'll just sit here and have my...
All right, so let's get into the topic. Things we wish we knew about parenting before we became a parent. Because if we had known them, we wouldn't have become a parent, which is half of the reason people don't tell you. That's why people don't say. People don't tell the truth about parenting because they want to trick you into joining the parenting collective.
Okay.
Because it is a cult, and that's what I call it. It's like
the
Borg or Scientology.
Not all of these things are just going to be things that would have kept you.
So
maybe you'll have some delights along the way that are big, happy surprises about being a parent.
Come on, let's be serious. So as I said at the top, one of the reasons I started my blog was to maintain my identity, but the other was to put the, and especially as the blog went on and I actually had a kid, it was the put to lie to the idea that there are parenting experts or there's some parenting blueprint or there's one way to do things or anything like that. So D_Hildy kind of summarized my thoughts where she said, she wished she knew that it is impossible to prepare yourself mentally to become a parent when you haven't been a parent before. And it is. It doesn't matter if you read What to Expect When You're Expecting or if you listen to, although listening to this episode of the podcast will do a really good job, I'm sure. But there's no way to know what it's like. And that there's a variety of reasons for that, right? And we're going to get into a lot of those. Again, as I said, I sort of knew that. I didn't have any experience with kids. I had a pretty good idea that I didn't know anything about it. But a lot of people, I think, who have little siblings or nieces and nephews probably think, hey, I know what to do. I remember I was at Memorial Day, a barbecue with my brother and some of his friends. And one of the dudes was just like, he was like an uncle to his brother's kids. Not an uncle to somebody else's kids. That wouldn't make any sense. And he was like, oh, this is what I do with them. You know, I take them to the zoo and I do this. This is what you have to do. You got to sit down. She's like, buddy, you have the kids fucking 3 hours and you got some ice cream. You don't know what the fuck you're talking about.
Okay.
Until you have kids, you don't know what it's like. And then your whole world is destroyed.
10,000,000%, especially that douchebag. But
get any parenting advice from people that don't have kids?
Which
blow it out your ass, Uncle
I
Roman.
Certainly never did, but I did have numerous younger siblings who also procreated at an advanced rate.
Like rabbits.
Rabbits, our family. So I've been around babies like most of my life. And so like the basics I kind of sort of knew. But yeah, no, I mean, my mom had 5 kids. To this day, I have no fucking idea how she did that, or yeah. why.
No,
but
certainly no, not
I
why.
Actually think I figured out why. My older sister was 6 years above me.
The tax break.
And then my younger sister was 5 years below me. She literally had built-in sitting from like...
Oh, yeah. That's
you know
clutch.
What I mean? By the time she's 10... I was thinking about this earlier today because I was have telling that in a story. Years, yeah. And I was like, no. But she had it for like... I mean,
the whole
there
run.
Was like a two-year-old. She had like 30 years
she's
of
like, I'm
sitting.
Out of here.
I don't know. She was...
I
don't
get my
know
diet,
like,
my rum and Diet Coke. I go to the casino boat, right? You grew up in the Ozarks, right? Anyway,
that's
essentially.
Right, that's right.
So what are the through lines of the responses that we got? And again, I got a ton. So I broke them into subtopics because I'm a fucking professional. And the first subtopic we're going to get into is how no one knows anything. So K.A. Ingram said that she wished she had known that no one really knows what the hell they're doing and every parent is just trying their best to figure it out. And Mallory Alsop said the same thing. Everyone is making it up as they go. No one really knows what the fuck, which is 100% true, right? So don't believe anybody who tells you they know how to do it or they're doing it perfect or anything like that because it's all BS. It's all a fluke. You do something right, it's a fluke. You do something wrong, who knows? You just got to keep throwing stuff at the wall and seeing what sticks. You're not even, and I say this all the time, you're not even going to know if this parenting shit you did paid off for like 30 years.
Well, that's why I like to say, you know, and my therapist helped me discover that one. It really is a long game.
Yes,
it is a
it's
long,
a marathon,
long
not a
game.
Sprint. Yeah.
And when I'm sitting there in the therapy chair, younger, in my younger days, like...
We should get a therapy chair.
The built-in therapist. No, you know, just thinking about the fact that, like, us parents worry so much every day. And the fact is, if you love them and you care that much... You're probably doing a great job.
Yeah.
That's what the therapist
even
said.
Even if you suck.
She was like, but
you
know, we
try.
Don't really know for like, you know, 25, 30
years. My parents
years,
still
they'll
don't know. I'm 44. I visited my parents this week and they're like, I don't know.
They
know.
They think they have doubts.
They know they blew it. They know
they blew it. The legit actual comment from Grandma and Barry is, you and your sick sense of humor.
Like she doesn't have one.
This is what she brings up at the holiday table.
I don't remember what I said, but I bet it was hilarious.
She said it several times.
So Blake Nickel, N-I-C-K-L-E, said it's okay to have no clue what you're doing and it's okay to learn as you go, which I think is one of the things that I try to put forth on my blog and my social media presence is that I don't know what I'm doing. I'm not an expert. I'm an idiot. Any idiot can have, what is it? What is a Furious Style saying, Boys in the Hood? Any fool with a dick can have a baby, but it takes a real man to raise his kids? Boys in the
I
Hood,
say
you
that
know.
All the time. I say that all the time.
All the time.
It's
I think
on
he says
my
any fool
plate.
With a ding-a-ling. Anyway, that's true, right? And nobody knows what they're doing. There's no right or wrong. You just have to care. You just have to try. But I think a lot of parents go into it with expectations that they're supposed to be able to do this right earlier or they're supposed to get this right. None of that. It's true. None of that means shit. Kids have been surviving for millennia, right? And cavemen didn't know anything, right? Am I right? Anyway, I thought this was a good point. Cilia, S-Y-L-I-A-A, said that she wished she had known that everyone else's opinions are garbage because all of parenting is so personal. And I think that that's a really good point, too. Something that works for you and your family or for your kids is not going to work for somebody else's. It's not... transferable.
Well, I mean,
it's not apples
of all,
to apples.
You know, every single baby is completely different. Like, you know, even just talking about that baby you dropped on your his face earlier. You know, when we're talking
shout
about,
out to
oh,
Will. Love
he
you.
Couldn't he couldn't stand it all. He was X amount of months. Da-da. Every kid's different, right? Like, the hammer was fucking speed
off
chasing
and running,
across,
yeah.
right?
And like whereas, my and Uncle and Barry's kids, like his youngest just
too.
Walking real quick.
Right, exactly. Where our first kids were just huge sloth like creatures just sat on their asses.
Yeah, just
know?
Getting waited on. Hand
but,
and foot.
You know, and their speeches are different. Obviously the hammer mm-hmm. has speech delays
yeah.
that he works really hard on. Everything is different. So don't listen to whatever the fuck Karen said. Always has to be
Karen. You actually have a friend named Karen.
No, she's a good parent. She's a good mom. She's real good. I usually don't use
Karen reference. Anyway, she doesn't listen to this. Let's be honest. All right. So the next subtopic, again, I'm a professional, is about phases, right? So Jacqueline with an L-Y-N, there's a bunch of periods in between there. I'm okay. Not going to read them all. Said, sorry. Well, Jacqueline cares. I appreciate you, Jacqueline. Thank you for the input. She said she wished she had known that it is hard all the time. It doesn't matter how old they get. It's just a different kind of hard with each age, which is 100% true, right? So babies are hard, especially if it's your first baby, because you never sleep. You're up every 3 hours feeding the kid. Your breasts and your nipples are sore. It's really hard. You get mastitis. You need a cabbage.
What the hell do you know?
I know. Come on. I know. I've lived it.
Also, don't use the cabbage. I don't know. I don't stand by
that. They have challenges. I've said before that babies are mostly just inconvenient, and that is the kind of thing that you can say when you have a toddler or an older kid, because you realize that with every age, the challenges change. It doesn't necessarily get easier. It gets hard in different ways. So some stuff gets easier, and then something new comes along that is much harder than anything you had to deal with.
Hold on. Let's call this out here. Let's talk a little bit about phases, because I got a lot to say about phases.
Do you?
Yes. For one, the other day you made a very similar joke or comment, I guess, being like, babies are just mainly inconveniences, you know, and blah, blah, blah.
Well, all kids are inconveniences,
and
let's be honest.
One of your followers, or several of your followers, were quick to be like, I don't know that mom and Barry, like the breastfeeding woman of the group, and so many followers also know us so well, which is amazing, that they knew that baby number two had colic. He was more than a inconvenience for me.
Look, man.
Like 24/7 for like 4 months where he just screamed and hung on my breast.
Specific elements and circumstances. And yes, it sucked. And it wasn't just, the colic didn't just suck for you. It sucked for me too. I'm trying to sleep.
No,
here.
You forgot.
Baby is screaming.
You seem to forget some of that. So, but that being said, you know, there are phases like I loved the baby stage. I loved the newborn stage with both of the babies, right? But like more so with the munch because he didn't scream in my face 24/7.
I just find it a little boring, right? The same way, so Tides and Vibes, Tides_N_Vibes says that she wished she had known that the baby stage is the easiest because the smaller they are, the smaller their problems, which is true. Like, look, God forbid you have a baby that has like health problems or anything like that. That's a different thing. Colic sucks. All the shit sucks. They can't fall asleep. But in terms of, you know, comparing a baby to like a 16-year-old who's like freebasing crack cocaine and, you know, getting in the car and driving and, you know, there's peer pressure. There's some real challenges.
Well,
when a kid gets a personality, that's tough. But my point is they have smaller problems, but I think the rewards are smaller too, right? So which is why I'm not a super fan of the babies. Like, I can't show the baby the Terminator movie. He's not going to understand what's going on. You can't grasp the intricacies of time travel when you're 9 months old. that kid is so high, he is gonna love it, right? He's gonna totally be down with Skynet and it's gonna blow his mind, right? This is what I'm talking about.
Listen.
When you can have a conversation with the kid, when he's got a personality, when he's smiling and not just because he has gas, like, that's more rewarding than, you know, babies are cute and they're they're inconvenient, they wake you up all the time. 16-year-olds are not cute, and you know, you have to bail them out of jail and that kind of shit, and they're flunking out of school.
I don't know,
but you can have a conversation with them about like Tua and how he's going to do for the Dolphins this season.
Not when he's in jail for the free.
You can have a phone call.
Listen,
with
you're really just putting the worst case scenario out there. By the way,
well, that's what you think about as a parent, the worst case scenario all the time. It just haunts you.
You
constantly.
Specifically.
Me as well. We're going to get into that.
But I think that what is funny about the phases is definitely the first time around. If there's any new parents or like thinking to be
expecting parents,
or
you're around the fence.
You hear about like, you know, the trouble twos.
Oh, the terrible twos.
Terrible twos, right?
It's been so long for us, we don't remember.
Both of our kids.
They were fine.
They were lovely. They were lovely.
Every other year sucks.
And then, like, there's threes. I don't know what they tell you about threes.
Threenager.
Threenager, right.
There's another dumb name for
nobody cares.
And then
there's fuck you fours. Which
I've heard fuck my life fours lately.
Oh, yeah?
Which is not bad.
I would say that twos were wonderful. Threes were more difficult. our first kid definitely gave us a huge fuck you for. Our second one saved the fuck yous for till five. Yes, now it's really, right now. Jessica
McGowan says that she thought kids got easier as they got older. She realizes now she was wrong. Alias Loves Chris says she wished she had known that each year slash stage is harder, which is what I'm saying. She's like, I stupidly kept thinking I just had to get through this. And that's the trap every parent falls into. You're like, all right, I just got to get out of the colic phase, or I just got to get out of the potty training phase. But you just trade whatever that was for some new challenge, like having to do fucking fractions with your kid, which is an absolute nightmare, right? Or the crack cocaine thing, which we haven't gotten into yet, and God willing we won't, but we'll see, right? But at the same time, showed them the Terminator. Infinite Jess says it actually gets harder as they get older because instead of cleaning up their shit, you have to explain why the world is shit. So, you know, for our 10-year-old who has lived through the pandemic and has lived through Trump, and all that kind of stuff, like, you actually have to have real conversations. We get deep.
But he's also, like, just a really deep kid. And I think a lot of kids right now, all kids are aging faster than they need to, right? We're all going through it. They're dealing with some shit. And, you know, yeah, there's a lot more to explain these days, for sure. But, and we haven't even got to the teenage years. So, we're just going to, I've seen some bad things go down with family members.
You've seen some shit.
Yeah. So we're going to just cross our fingers.
So what's funny is, look at this awesome segue I had here. So at one point I had how nobody knows anything leading into the marriage subtopic. And my segue was, speaking of people that don't know anything, right? Your spouse.
Is that me?
No, it was actually for you to say about me because I don't know anything. So one of the other big subtopics was things people learned about parenting with their spouse, right? So Alice2411 says she wished she had known that you need to have a conversation with your partner about their, like, how they plan to raise their kids or their child raising philosophy, not just the conversation about, like, do you want to have kids, right? Because,
oh God, yeah,
right. That's... So it's if you get into it, if suddenly you're married, you're having a great time, you know, you're banging on the kitchen table kind of thing, and then you have a kid, and all of a sudden you realize, like, your spouse doesn't believe in spanking and you do, right? Or you want to homeschool and your spouse doesn't, or your spouse is a Scientologist and you aren't. Like, I don't know why you wouldn't be a Scientologist.
Just, I mean, I'll be completely honest here, like, a little honest moment that, like, around the time that Munch was five.
Like, getting into school?
Getting into school and, you know, being a little more difficult to deal with, but he was also... He had ADHD, and we were going through all of that.
Well, we didn't even know that yet. We suspected.
But perhaps I suspected even sooner than you did. And our parenting approaches were totally different. And I remember having we had some really big talks there about, like, that we weren't agreeing on how to parent these kids together. You know, and having to work through that. I think that it's something you should talk about. And, I mean, that being said... How much do you know to earn it, right?
Right, you don't. That's the theme of this entire episode, is you can't.
But even relationship-wise. And then you have to kind of meet in the middle and find either a way to work through it through, like, therapy or, like, coming to see eye to eye.
Well, see, so Liv_K_and_fam says that she wished she had known how many arguments she would get into with her spouse about how to parent the kids. It's literally all we fight about. And we argue about it, too. The thing is... Neither of us knows. We think we know what's best for our kid, right? And that's all you can do is try to know what's best for your kids, try to do what's best for your kids. But we have different philosophies sometimes, whereas she likes to give them every single thing they want, and I try not to, right? I'm just kidding.
Go fuck yourself. Okay, no, that's not what I would say. I would just say that perhaps, obviously, there's different nuances. You are.
Definitely. And for every kid.
As you will admit to, like, everyone here, that you're riding it like a what? On a 0
like
to
10? My temper scale?
I'm
an 8.5 all the time.
8.5 all the time. I mean.
Out of 6.
No, that's the baseline.
That's what I mean. That's simmer. I like to simmer.
And then it whoops. Whereas, like, you know, it jumps up there.
Yeah, and you ride at a 1, and then every once in a while, you obliterate everything
in
50-mile radius.
All the shit.
I'm King Kong, you're Godzilla. Doesn't even make sense.
That doesn't make sense.
Godzilla's so much better, though.
That movie was so fucking bad. It's not even
it wasn't that bad. What about Hollow Earth? All right, so Mandy underscore O'Keefe says that she wished she had known better how to communicate with her husband about sharing responsibilities for the baby. So we get this a lot. I mean, this is a theme, especially with moms in general, and Instagram and social moms, where their husbands don't do shit, or they like to trash husbands for not doing shit. I feel like I do a decent amount, and I was pretty good with the baby, aside from dropping my friend's baby on his face. This is the kid's fault, like, learn how to walk already. Like, I'm not a stranger to having responsibility for the baby. I don't consider myself a babysitter. I'm an actual parent.
Yeah, right? I mean, I guess this person's, Mandy's this, specifically talking about the
her
baby.
Her husband and her baby, her like, husband yeah. maybe not pulling his weight. Like, you know what? Get your nipple out once in a while. Bro, right?
No, I mean, I would say Danbury was so good, especially with number one, about like doing some of the middle of the night feedings. Number two literally wouldn't take anything but my breast for a year from anyone. I mean, if you had my breast with
so
you
in the movie
time,
Hereditary, Toni Collette's mother, the grandma breastfeeds the baby. That wouldn't, like, my mom tried and it was like no go. It was like no go.
No, the hammer was not having it.
So Missy Wolf 921 says that she wished she had known that it was normal for having kids to cause a strain on the marriage, right? It doesn't mean your marriage is broken. You've just added a shitload of stress to your life. Suddenly you're both trying to care for another human being aside from each other. You got a lot more responsibilities. It's a lot more expensive. There's a lot more on your mind, you know, right? So you're gonna butt heads. Even from the baby stage, you're gonna be exhausted. The mom is gonna feel like she's overtaxed because the baby only wants her breast. The dad is gonna feel like, you know, I'm working my fingers to the bone trying to provide for my family and bring home the bacon.
What?
This kind of stuff, what do you mean? This kind of stuff is gonna happen. Marriage, you know, what's the line that I love in Flirting with Disaster, the most underrated comedy of the past 25 years?
I might agree with that.
She says every marriage is vulnerable, otherwise marriage wouldn't mean anything. When you have kids, the vulnerability of your marriage really gets put on blast, right? Like somebody says down here later that somebody says, oh, right here, Julie B, B-E-E 22, says kids make everything worse. They don't fix your problems. And what I think she's referring to is a lot of times there's an idea that a baby can, like, save a relationship or a marriage.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, I'm sure there are people out there that have tried that, and that does not seem like a good idea to me.
No, it doesn't.
That's a pretty high-stakes bet, and I'm just not that woman.
You're going to love your kid, but it doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to, like, bond closer together with your spouse or that it's going to fix everything. In a lot of cases, it might make things worse.
Everyone's, again, back to everyone's experience is different. I will say that for us, or at least me anyway, with both kids, during the baby stage where it's like new baby, new family.
Shit, yeah.
No. I felt like we were
us
stronger.
Against the world,
we felt closer. You seemed more romantic somehow. I don't know if it's hormones
or you were just being a
better
cuckoo.
Human.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I think that like when your wife's up all night, like with a colicky baby on her boob, you might be a little nicer and not like fuck with her the next morning because she will kill you. So you're
doesn't
probably
sound like
sweeter
me.
To
doesn't
me.
Sound like me.
Oh, you've had your moments. See, this is about earlier in the show. We're talking about how like the divide between the character of Danbury and actual Danbury just keeps going inching closer and closer.
You know what? I'm like Daniel Day-Lewis. I don't break character, right? If that means I gotta you know keep drilling those jokes when the cameras aren't on. What's going to happen? You know, I got to win those Oscars. So, Peck Larusky, this is interesting. She said that she wished she had known that she would sometimes be so kid-touched out that she wouldn't want her husband to touch her, right? Her kids are all up on her all the time. And sometimes she's just sick of the human contact.
Oh my God, that bothered me right there. That really bothered me.
It sounds like an MP.
If you're not watching.
The kids aren't even touching her and she bothered by me.
No. What I was going to actually say is, for those who are not watching the video, don't please.
Oh, I touched her.
He's touching all over me. And
all
I actually have had a few days where the hammer specifically wants to touch me all the time. Like, literally coming in four times a night. Like, just, I'm so touched out. I was, like, just
everyone
so disgusted
get away from me, yeah.
in every way. So, no offense.
That's a real
You're
thing
right,
that happens.
Though.
Kids don't like to touch me, so I wouldn't worry about that. Newswoman 007 says that she wished she had known that you should pick a kind, gentle, and patient partner to to have kids with because it makes the bumpy road easier. You wish you had known that too, because yes, I seriously. Am not kind, gentle,
hey, newswoman, or patient. 007. Let me know if you know someone, okay?
So, again, I arrange these comments that I've gotten to segue seamlessly into the subtopic.
Okay,
so,
come on.
Kasja underscore W, K-A-S-J-A underscore W says, even with the best partner, the mental load is crushing most of the time. And that's what we're going to get into now, the mental load. And I do agree, even for a dad, and there is this stereotype out there that dads don't have anxiety and don't worry and that kind of stuff, which I think bloggers like me and some of my... you know, brethren and just the world in general is changing to understand that, you know, it's okay for guys to have emotions and feelings too. I don't have emotions and feelings, but the mental load is legitimate. I will lay awake at night worrying. I worry about different things than you worry about. Like I worry about the crack cocaine thing and I worry about, you know, money and that kind of stuff.
There, I do know you worry about money and I do know you worry about things. I also know you do not lie awake at night.
No,
your
I go
head
to sleep.
Hits the fucking pillow and you're done.
It doesn't
and
do
I
any good.
Laying there
I
for
need
hours.
My rest. I need my rest to get my mind right.
Having
so,
your own concerns.
L Shell, S-C-H-E-L-L 11 says that she wished she had known how much she would miss the mental freedom that comes from not having kids. And they do. Once you have a kid, there's never you're never not thinking about them at some
it's
point.
It's impossible.
Right? Mego underscore Saur, S-A-U-R, like Megasaur, says she wish she had known how much worry there is. I knew it would be hard and stressful, but not how often I'd worry. I joke about this from time to time where, you know, when we visited my parents this weekend, we didn't go out anywhere. We stayed at home among the vaccinated and safe. But when we used to visit and we would go out, like we would get home at like midnight, my parents, at least one of my parents would be like waiting up to make sure that we got home okay. I'm in my 40s.
It
never goes
like
away. You
kids.
Never stop worrying about your kids.
You know, they were probably making sure you weren't doing all that
crack
and
cocaine,
heroin
yeah.
you keep talking about. And well, they
I do that at home. I do
go
that
to sleep.
In the house. I don't do that. I don't go into New Haven and do that.
But
my
no, I do think, obviously, you're constantly thinking about something. And there's also, I would say, always something new to think about. Like mm-hmm. this year, even if there wasn't a pandemic, we were going through like middle school and kindergarten applications, which in New York is like a big thing. I know it doesn't make fucking sense, but it's like this huge stressor. It's like getting your kid
yeah,
into
you're not
Harvard,
just slotted into your neighborhood school. There's a whole fucking rigmarole.
But like, there's always everything else, right? If you, when the hammer started having speech delays, when
oh,
you know
shit.
The other one. Started having ADHD,
oh,
like,
shit.
You know, there's always a new thing, not to mention just the whole, like, how are they emotionally coping with, like, yeah. real life, and then, oh, now it's a pandemic of, like, complete insane magnitudes that no one could ever grasp. How are they dealing with that?
I mean, there's normal stuff, there's big stuff. Are they getting bullied? Are they getting bullied online? Are they, do they understand Common Core? Are they doing crack cocaine? Like, there's just so many, they never stop.
Yes,
there's always
there
something.
There will always be an endless list.
And on top of that, you worry about how your own choices and your own parenting and your own way you relate to your kids impacts mm-hmm. them, which again, you're not going to know for a long time. But Amanda Rama.3 says, she says she had known that you will always be second guessing your parenting abilities. And I will
parent
say,
parent guilt, mom guilt. It's
I have
huge.
Said, I've written blog posts about this, and you said it earlier. Whereas if you are concerned about your parenting, that's a good sign, right? If you're questioning whether the parenting moves you're making are correct, the fact that you care and have anxiety about it and worry about it, I mean, maybe not the anxiety, but that you're concerned about it is a good thing because you're obviously tuned in and are aware of how important this kind of stuff is, right? Rocky Patton says she didn't know how much she was going to worry all the time, not just when the kids were teens and doing crack cocaine. She didn't say that was me. It was just...
Okay, let's...
The Jody underscore Mead says that she didn't know that she would be able to be so mad and feel so guilty for being mad all at the same time. This happens to me a lot, whereas I'll blow up at one of my kids or I'll yell too much and then, and then 5 minutes later I'll be like, shit, I shouldn't have done that. And for me, the important thing is if you do screw up with your kids, whether it's losing your temper or doing whatever, that you let them know, hey, you know, you calm down or whatever. A couple minutes later, you'd be like, hey, look, they apologize, explain, be like, hey, I'm human too. I have emotions, even though I don't really have emotions. I let them think that. And I'm like, every once in a while, I make mistakes, even though I don't really, obviously.
Okay,
but,
come on with your fucking shtick. You have all kinds of problems.
Shtick.
Everyone knows it.
I do have a lot of problems. But you just got to come clean and be like, look, I shouldn't have done that. And that goes a long way. And I do, a lot of times you see in like movies and stuff where like a parent has too much pride to like apologize to their kid or hug their kid or whatever.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's heartbreaking.
It is heartbreaking, but I can see it happening.
I would leave you immediately.
If what?
I mean, because if, you know, if you missed that, what was that thing that Jennifer Aniston said about like he was missing a chip?
Pivot. Is that it?
No, it wasn't Pivot.
That was Ross.
It was like this thing in the tabloids where Jen Aniston said Brad Pitt was missing like a chip, like a just a chip that made him a human emotional person at one point. Yeah, it was famous in an article. And I think like you screaming
I am
a
lot like Brad Pitt. That's true. Is that what you were going to say? You remind me a lot of Brad Pitt. Is that what you were going to say?
Oh, God.
Thank you. I usually get Paul Rudd, but I'll take the Brad Pitt. Thank you.
If you were just an asshole to the kids and you didn't give a fuck and then you were cold-shouldered them, fuck you. How about that?
But here's the thing.
You keep stepping on the words I'm saying, so this is my point.
Here's the thing. I am an asshole to the kids sometimes, but I do give a fuck about being an asshole.
I know. Which goes a long way. I said that's your only redeeming quality. That's what I just said.
My only redeeming quality. It doesn't solve everything, and it would be better if I weren't an asshole. But the fact that I'm aware of being an asshole... It's kind of like when you like make a shitty joke and hurt somebody's feelings and then you're like, oh, if you don't get the joke, you're the asshole. That's the kind of attitude you have when you're like 17, 18. Then eventually you realize I have some responsibility here too. Maybe I shouldn't have made the asshole joke or been the asshole unless it was really, really funny. All right. So BKLEIN Fowler says, you're literally never going to think you're parenting right and that's okay. And again, I think that you're not. You're not going to know. You're never going to know. I don't care what you read and what to expect when you're expecting and if you're hitting all the fucking shit it says in that book or whatever. You're never going to know for like 30, 40 years. The important thing is that you care about getting better and trying and you care about how your kids react and you care about how your kids are feeling, right?
Yeah, no, obviously.
Maggie Russell didn't think that you would care, that it was possible to care this much, that she would care, worry, and question everything. But you know what? That's the way it goes. Here we go. Look at it.
Well, no, I mean, immediately though, like, I don't know. I think a lot of moms anyway feel this way because it might be different for dads, but it might not be because you were saying how like, you know, moms carry the babies, but no, not all moms are made that way.
No.
Some are adopted, you know, obviously.
There's
all the
lots of different ways.
It's
the 21st century, guys.
What my experience was definitely like, I could not believe I loved someone so fucking much.
And they weren't
so
even born yet.
Immediately. Yeah. The minute that, like, Munch
took
was
me
put
a
on
while,
my chest.
Let me tell you about it.
I mean, it took him a while to come around. And then a lot of moms deal with, like, postpartum depression, which I did too the second time around. So I totally get that. But either way, even when you're going through that, you know you love the kid so fucking much. And that's what makes everything, all the stakes so much
higher. Well, then you worry that you're failing the kid and there's the guilt with all that and just all this crazy shit. It's amazing.
Do you hear this delightful, if there's
yeah,
anyone
so
at home
it is
thinking
a lot,
about
it,
having
look,
kids.
It's a blast. Right? That's the main message we want to get out there. Is just
circle
it's just,
of
I keep doing
guilt.
It's not like I'm eating the baby, although, you know what?
Circle right. of guilt and fear and horror and guilt and fear.
Bob Doesn't IG says, I wish I knew that despite my best efforts, some irrational fear over mundane things happens, right? So I have that irrational fear where the same reason that like my parents would stay up and wait for me to get home even when I'm in my 40s, you know, you worry when the phone rings, all this stuff. And I think a lot of this stuff, you worry about the toddlers and little kids because they're so fucking stupid and they were like running in traffic without any idea. But it's when they start to kind of break away and when they're teenagers and they're going out. Like, I can't imagine the anxiety I'm going to have. Every once in a while, I think about it. Like, what's going to happen
really?
When the kids like in the park?
Holy
like,
shit.
Oh,
I'm
shit.
Already dealing with this.
Right? So, like.
Here's a fun fact about Dad and Barry that you would not expect.
Uh-oh.
So, when we had toddlers, which we do not now. But when we had toddlers and we went to the playground.
Oh, God. Watch them like a hawk.
No. You think you know helicopter hair?
Oh, stop it.
Oh, my God. You were like puppet parent. You had like...
Puppet parent.
You had your hand like up that kid's ass all
oh
the fucking
God.
Time.
You just come up with that?
Yes, I did. Because I happened to see this other
puppet
like...
parent.
I swear, 12-month-old... running around all willy-nilly.
That's a year. 12 months is a year.
Yeah,
just say a year.
What I'm saying. A 12-month-old at, like,
don't
a playground I had my 5-year-old at. And they're running around just like doing shit, going ahead down the slide. There wasn't a parent to be seen. And I'm like, I would be upset in that situation.
Well,
you would have cardiac fucking arrest.
I wrote a blog post about it once, how like we were at like a park and we were like in line for a food truck and then we sat down on a picnic and Detective Muntz like ran off and I was like eating my shit, my kimchi fucking taco or whatever. And all of a sudden, next thing I know that he's peeling down a hill and his legs are out from under him and he's going to fall and I'm late to get him. And he's falling and I see him and he's falling and his face is about to hit a metal grate. And some woman sticks her hand out. I wrote a blog post about it. Check it out. Sticks her hands out.
Look at him.
Catches his cheek in between the grate and his. It was like amazing. She saved his whole fucking face. And I grabbed him and ran away. I didn't even thank the woman. Like I was just so flustered and I felt like such a shithead because I didn't have my hand far enough up his ass, being the papa parent.
Down the fucking kimchi taco, would you?
Well, I was hungry.
Jesus Christ.
So, you mentioned the postpartum depression. Jay Alberton, 18, says she wished she had known how mentally hard pregnancy was. She said she'd known about PPD, but she'd never thought about depression / anxiety during pregnancy, which I think is interesting, right? So, like, when you're carrying the baby,
absolutely.
Obviously, your lifestyle has to change a shitload
right.
when you have a human person inside you and all that stuff. And so, that's
an
interesting
point. It does not have to
be.
The whole post part of PPD is so bullshit. Right. It can totally be during
just
it. And if you
yeah.
think you're going through that now, please seek help. And I mean, and I know that person also mentioned how long PPD can last, which is true. Like I was really having a very hard time with the hammer when we were about to celebrate his first birthday. It didn't even feel like it was him.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I had no idea. He was born in January. There was the very end of that year. I was having a horrible time for a lot of reasons, but the
collagen
baby was
help.
A huge part of it. And she's like, "Oh, it could be PPD," and I'm like, "Oh, but he's gonna be 1 year soon." She
yeah,
was like,
you didn't
"So,
think that, yeah.
like, it can still happen." And
that's a good one from Jay Alberton. It's a good stuff to consider. All right, so. Another popular one was about how you get no rest when you have kids. And I didn't even put most of them here. I got a ton of comments about how you never get any rest. You're always tired. You have no idea how tired you could possibly be because that's what happens, right? So whether you have a baby or a toddler or whatever, they're waking you up constantly. Our kids still wake us up at like six in the morning.
I got a Q&A the other day. It was funny because I was doing a Q&A and someone said, "Oh my God, please tell me that I'm going to sleep through the night before my kid is, say, 5 years old," and literally, I'm, like, laying with a 5-year-old, and my dad's like, fuck no.
Look, it obviously depends on the kid. It depends on what you do. We did cry it out. We stand by it. You know, we didn't abuse the kids. Everybody
you know what?
Down.
We cried it out the first time.
The second time, didn't
the second work. Time, we cried a lot, and so did he, and eventually it worked.
So, the thing is, there's no banking sleep before you have a kid, so this isn't helpful to new
oh
parents.
My
you can't,
God.
Like, sleep extra now. It's not going to make a difference. You can't be more well-rested in 5 years because you slept more this year. That's
nothing
so stupid.
Makes me angrier.
So dumb.
Then, you know, fucking great Aunt Jane at the fucking baby shower saying like, "Oh, you know, sleep now."
Yeah.
What the fuck am I gonna do with that?
I will
sleep
say,
later,
if
Jane.
Oh my God! Glad there's no Janes in my family. So I will say that if you are a person who likes to like nap and sleep, you know, you get it now because you're never gonna get it again. And you're gonna miss it. There's also no catching up on sleep. It doesn't matter once you and I've written about this again. Once you have kids, there's no recovery time. Like you don't, even if you get to sleep in one day every 3 weeks, it doesn't make a dent, right? You've just, once you have the baby, you're up constantly and then
right.
the toddler, there's no respite. You never get to recover. What you end up having to do is you have to learn how to function because you still have to be a parent. You still probably have a job of some kind, whether it's parenting or in an office or whatever. You have to live your life with always being exhausted with as little sleep as possible. That's what you need to get used to. You should join the Army or the Navy SEALs and learn how to live with sleep deprivation, and that will prepare you. The Navy SEALs. You know, it's a little bit easier.
All right. Yeah. Okay. So listen, you're never going to sleep again. You're always going to be exhausted. Life's going to suck. Next topic.
All right. So the next topic is about how when you have kids, you lose all your free time and sometimes you lose your identity, as we alluded to at the beginning of the podcast. So Calm Dan J says, she wished she had known how, or maybe he wished he knew how time-consuming parenting is. Even when they're not around, his life or her life really does revolve around them, which again, this goes part and parcel with the mental load, right? They're never not on your mind. Everything you do in some way or another, you have the kids and how it's going to impact the kids or whatever in your head. Do you agree?
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm just thinking about this, you know, how time consuming it is and, you know, how your life revolves around them. Just one of my immediate thoughts is just we do have followers that are not parents and just other places on the interwebs we see them. And the number one thing you see from people who do not have kids this year mm-hmm. of a pandemic is, holy shit, I'm so glad I'm not you. I can't believe you're doing this. Like, parents who have to parent right now, like, it's not just again, your mind revolves around them. You're literal every fucking minute.
Especially when you're
life.
Stuck in the house with them all the time. Yeah, there's
right.
no escape.
And I mean, perhaps some of that is changing now, you know, at a slow pace, but what a fucking year.
Kellen B7 says, how much I wish I'd known how much I can't do what I want when I want, even simple things. I'm on their schedule. Oh, Dana Storley, Storlie, says, she wishes she had known how you never have a moment to yourself ever again. Slussy face says the same thing. Get used to doing nothing by yourself ever again. Shitting, running, grocery shopping, nothing. They're always there. Always.
I have a couple comments about a couple different things.
Shitting?
Let's start with this. If you're not prepared to hold a baby while you're shitting, you should not have a child.
Yeah.
If you're not prepared to hug a child while you're shitting, you know, just a grown one, halfway grown, like a 5-year-old will run in and just be like, I need a hug. And you're like, but I'm pooping. They don't care. No. Just saying, it's not just exactly when it's a baby. And then the other thing being about working around the kid's schedule. I mean, that's been such a huge thing in general, right? Like even just, you know, yes, this year is different, but one of my biggest complaints recently has been how, like, I want to go even do an online yoga class or take a bike ride or run to a grocery store. I mean, you know, in fucking, you know, whole gear and everything.
Yeah,
being terrified of the grocery
the
store.
Hazmat suit,
exactly. But it's like, oh, but he has this at 10:30 and then 11:15
and then I gotta go get him from
this. And it's not even just this year. I mean, especially as they get older and they get interests and you have after school and you're running around their schedule, not to mention your own work schedule.
We're going to have to start doing these like from the car while we're waiting for our kids to finish their activities that we have to pick them up from, because that's the only
nightmare.
That and like going to the dentist is the only free time you get, which is interesting, right?
We should all go to the dentist.
I put the time and identity thing in the same category because you spend so much time caring for your kids that you lose your hobbies. That's why so many parents stay up late or get up super early because they need like alone time. Even my mom said this to you this weekend.
This was awesome, honestly, because MJ's mom is 80, so he was the baby of the family. She's on the older end, right? So she was, what?
I look great.
Okay, fine. But
so is my mom, by the way.
Just
good
saying,
genes, youthful genes.
She does. She looks amazing. Point being, though, what's her oldest son's age?
You mean my brother?
Yeah.
He's 54.
Exactly.
10 years older than me.
Being a mom 54 years ago, she is telling me how she used to stay up extra late mm-hmm. every night and just be
churning butter
morning.
And shit. What did they
do
back then? I don't know.
You see these jokes about, oh, it's because it's Instagram. Oh, it's because of Netflix.
No.
She was ready to fucking stare at a goddamn wall.
That's all they had back then. The walls were fucking popping back
whatever
in the 50s.
It doesn't matter.
60s.
Her kid was asleep. It's almost good to know. That it's just
yeah,
forever.
It doesn't change.
It
you know, the
change.
Methods
it's
change, but
us.
The madness doesn't. I fucking nailed that one. I gotta say, I think the best thing that came out of this podcast so far was puppet parenting. I like that. Okay. I'm really impressed. So Marlena_912 says it's important to do something for yourself, and you know, because it's easy to lose yourself when you're caring for children. Which again was one of the main themes of my blog when I started it, was find a way to maintain my personality and my sense of humor and my social life and that kind of stuff, because I didn't want myself to change. Maybe it probably should have changed a little bit more. I'd be a better dad, but I'm not, right? Because this guy's pretty great as a person, not as a dad. So you got to maintain some of that stuff, whether it's finding a hobby, finding some free time or whatever, which is why one of the reasons I started the podcast was so like me and Pete could go hang out. Right. Now there's a pandemic.
He's
me and Pete, it's all virtual. I'm stuck with you.
He's in our bedroom.
Pete would have never come up with puppet parenting. Let me tell you that.
But it is. I don't know. I wouldn't say my identity is gone, but my time to focus on those prior parts of my identity that, you know, I kind of liked, they don't come along as much. You know, like I like to dance, I like to party, I like to wear sequins. I still do wear sequins a lot around the kids.
For no reason. For literally no reason.
But even just think about the people, you know, the things you might have done otherwise, right? Like a lot of people around later in life start like painting and everything.
My mom.
And yeah, you might start doing that, but
if she hadn't had kids, she'd probably be like the next Van Gogh. But we had kids and you know what? She had to devote a lot of time to my brothers and myself, and it ruined her life. It's just the way it goes.
Good news, she's painting again. Shift your priorities.
Right.
She's all right.
So the last couple of, again, we split this up into two episodes. There's a lot more shit to get into.
Oh my God, so much
next
shit.
Next week about why it's okay to hate your kids. It's a big thing for me. We're going to get into that next week, either with you or Pete. Hopefully Pete can join his
daughter. He really daughter wants is, me to not be here.
His daughter is back in ballet, right? So he can't always make
have
it.
Have you talked about how cool his daughter is?
We have a lot of times. Mergers and acquisitions. She's pretty cool. All right, so that's her nickname. So a couple of random things I wanted to get to before we wrap up this episode, right? So J.K.S. Smith says he wish he had known that they literally never shut the fuck up, ever. Literally never. I assumed people were exaggerating. It's impossible to exaggerate. So we keep talking about the hammer. He's five. He had a speech delay. You know, he wasn't talking much at the beginning. We were with my parents this weekend. They were like, holy shit, this dude never fucking stops talking. Like, look, it's not all completely clear. We understand it, but it's very good. But he can't stop talking. He can't.
That I don't even think I put out there yet, which is like his new favorite catchphrase is, excuse me, I need to say something. Only he needs to say something.
The most nonsense thing you've ever heard.
Every day.
No, the best catchphrase is that I've taught him when he asks for something nicely, he has to quote Superman 2. He has to say, please, General, sir, please put my father down. Nobody gets it.
No one makes...
Anyway, so Elise_Patrick. Elise is the name of the mom on Family Ties. Love it. Says that sometimes the noise gets overwhelming. I now understand the term, I can't hear myself think. And I will agree, especially with, we have two kids. We're going to get into some of the misconceptions or whatever people have with multiple kids next week. But I got to say, it is unbelievably loud. The two kids, they're always at each other.
I'm a little better at dealing up. Well, here's the thing. If they're screaming at each other, obviously we got problems. And I'm going to notice it. But sometimes, like, the white noise of children just being loud
as fuck.
I can ignore it. And you cannot. No. It just grates on your soul.
It does. It grates on my soul. Troublesome Trader says, vacations are so fucking hard. As people like to say, when you go with kids, they're not vacations, they're trips. Right?
True.
Because you're not relaxing. I shared my old post about how a few years ago on winter break, we went to Philadelphia. And the kids were all in the same room and the kids were sleeping. And we had to go into the hallway to like pop the champagne and have a little happy hour out in the hallway because it's the only way to have any kind of alone time when you're all in the same hotel room on a trip.
Champagne. It was just like warm beer. And
it was Zima. You used to fucking love Zima.
In high school, I did love
really?
Zima. I did.
You shouldn't be drinking illegally. It leads to crack cocaine. And then Candidly Kim says that she wished she had known how fucking long it takes to get in the car and leave your house.
Yes. That's what I wish I knew before getting married. Because look, I guarantee you,
please,
Dad and Buried is ready to leave the house 20 minutes after the fact.
False.
Like, all the kids are in the car.
You are doing makeup for like 45 minutes after we're all ready. So then what happens is we're all ready to go, and then we have to cycle through a whole thing. So by the time you finish the makeup, we've all gotten wrapped up in the latest episode of Falcon and Winter Soldier, and we need to finish it.
Anyone who's seen my stories knows there's not a whole ton of makeup going on. And second, first of all, you're not starting shows. I have literally had the kids in the car. Dad and Barry said he's ready. He's let them all in. He's opened the door. He's taken the keys with him. I'm like stuck in a 100-degree car. Dudes, let's be honest. Dudes in the bathroom. Dudes taking a shit. And like,
Are my bowels on a schedule? Are my bowels on a schedule?
They are on a schedule. They have to go.
I can't control my bowels.
They have to go the minute we try to leave the house.
It happens when it happens. It's not natural to deny your bowels. Right. All right. You know what? Hopefully Pete will be back for next week. We can have about,
you
know,
of all of this.
You can check out the podcast on Apple, Spotify, everywhere you listen to podcasts. Please subscribe and tell your friends. Guys, you know, you can't deny your bowels. Just the way it is. Mm-hmm. We'll catch you next week. Maybe she'll be here. Maybe she won't.
Bye.
Peace.